These days, you don't need a label to get your music into online shops. With our service, your music will be available in over 200 online stores within weeks. And that is worldwide.
I think things like TuneCore and Bandcamp are really cool for bands, you know, like it really breaks down the walls. It used to be that you could not get CDs in a store unless you had a major distributor.
And that's a concept I don't think people really understand. Like years ago, that was multiple record deals, distribution, logistics involved to do that, to be able to ship a CD across to Japan, and now it's like TuneCore, afternoon, you're done.
Nowadays, everything that a label does, you can do yourself.
Hire your own publicist if you want. You can press records yourself, you know. You don't, as long as you have the budget, or even the know-how to do it, or friends in the right places, any band can do that.
I definitely think that at this point, everybody could just be doing, and everybody probably will be soon, just releasing music themselves, you know.
Labels no longer have a stranglehold on the industry, you know. The internet has kind of leveled the playing field to a degree so that people can kind of do it on their own. But it's still pretty rare to find bands totally doing it on their own and surviving.
Labels can finance your band's recording. They can offer tour support. And if you have a real label with a staff, then you have multiple people that can work your record. Different departments, different people with different experiences, different relationships, different connections, and you hope that those people that work for the label, they can leverage the relationships that can help your band.
Sometimes they don't realize that, you know, without a lot of the backing that comes with being signed to a label, it's sometimes hard to get people to pay attention because a lot of people still are used to the old guard way of thinking, oh, if they're not signed, oh, they're just some unsigned band playing in a bar, and that's not always the case.
I think you're going to be able to license your music to specific entities on the internet, and I believe that you're going to be able to manage your band digitally.
Can you develop yourself? Yeah. Can you do a lot of the services that labels were providing in the past? Yeah. Can you do it as well as them? That remains to be seen.
We're living in really exciting times right now. I mean, you can fund your record via Kickstarter, use those funds to record in a professional studio or even in your own home with Pro Tools, manufacture the product through disc makers or, you know, Pirates Press, hire your own publicist, distribute your product through TuneCore, Bandcamp, Big Cartel, and with all these things combined, you essentially just became your own label. But it is a lot of work, and I think it comes down to how much time and money you're willing to invest into the business side of your band.
There's a lot of things that the label takes care of for you to help push your music out to people that we just can't do on our own, you know. Like the guy that's going all over the country trying to get our song on active rock radio, you know, just that alone would, you know,
yeah,
take up all your time
crazy.
And then you have all the people overseas.
It could be a pretty strong partnership if the label knows how to work with the band and actually, you know, pushes them past where they could get themselves. It's kind of exciting though how far a band could get themselves these days without a label. I think that's really cool.
The hardest part of being in a band starting out, whether you're on a label or not, is getting people to pay attention to your music. Just because you made great music doesn't mean anyone's gonna listen to it.
And really with no distribution, even with the lackluster sales these days, with no distribution, it's very, very difficult.
Even Trent Reznor, a very established musician with Nine Inch Nails, he was like, you know what, screw labels, I'm gonna go at it alone. And he already had the built-in audience, he didn't have to do any marketing. And he put out a record by himself, and then eventually he realized this is too much work for me, and he went back to record labels.
This illusion that you can just self-release your own shit and it's gonna work is still somewhat of an illusion, you know? Like, distribution still in large part rules the game.
The differences are if you're working with a smaller company, they're going to make your records available, and for the most part, that's the end. With a company like Red, where I work, it's more of a actual release planning process, and not only put it up on the DSP, but help get it promoted.
And even though there's fewer stores to get records into, there are still stores, and it requires proper distribution. And of course, the world is much bigger than just maybe the US or your regional territory.
I think it's really about what you, again, what you as a band want to accomplish, and what's the best way to do that. And maybe it's a label, and maybe it's not.
I mean, by my definition, I have had just an astounding level of success. But that's my perspective as someone who has no intention of making this a career. I mean, for me, it's successful because it's a hobby, and it basically has doubled my income. I mean, that's an overwhelming success.
Success, to me, is having people actually wanting to hear what you do, which is a lot to ask. There's so many things going on that, like, you know, oh, so I made this song, and, you know, I think it's pretty good. And for someone to give a shit enough to pay money, even to somebody to steal it, is like, it's pretty special at this point.
I can't believe you don't own this fucking record. That's insane. Jesus.
I do think that labels act as like a tastemaker still.
You know, there's a much more equal playing field as far as getting your music in front of a lot of people. But it even more than ever, you need people with resources to differentiate kind of the noise from what's really important and what's and the bands that are willing to work and push things and evolve and things like that. So I think there still is a place for labels.
Labels act as gatekeepers. When you buy a record with the Nuclear Blast logo on it, there's a certain quality control involved. It means that the A&R guys at Nuclear Blast or Metal Blade or one of the other cool labels have put their stamp on it and said, this is cool, you will like this.
People follow labels for that reason. They follow them on social media, they subscribe to their newsletters, you know, they some people just buy anything that a label puts out.
As things get into subgenres, I think labels play more of an important role. Because the whole idea of a label is to be a filter.
I think that sort of label identification in some ways is becoming important all over again because it's so much harder to really sort of find the band that you really like because there's just so much shit out there.
Now, I think in some ways labels could be like a media outlet in the sense that there's curation involved. You know, I put a lot of time into seeking out great underground bands, but not everybody's going to do that. So paying attention to a label's roster is a good way for anybody to find out about these great new bands that fits a label's aesthetic. And not just the big ones either. I mean, Profound Lore, Brutal Panda, Willowtip, Southern Lord, these are all great bedroom labels that are putting out some of the best bands right now.
They literally are in your bedroom. That's not just a term. So hope to have a big bedroom because it starts to take up a lot of space.
People still have the desire to start a record label, even though, you know, CD sales are down, worse than ever. You know, vinyl sales are kind of up.
People who care about music, care about physical packaging, they're getting into vinyl, even if they weren't into vinyl a year ago or something. That's why that keeps increasing. That's why we're busier than ever at Pirates Press and it keeps growing.
The fact that someone, you know, puts investment into art that they believe strongly in, I mean, who would say that's a bad thing?
They can't offer tour support. They're not going to spend money on advertising for you. They're not going to get your music licensed. People hear that like your band is on Profound Lore, maybe they'll pay attention more than if it was DIY, but it's not like being signed to Roadrunner.
It's all about baby steps. You know, you like working with these guys. They can't do much for you. You can't do much for them, but you can do a little bit for each other. Then a little bit more comes out of it. Then you meet some other cat and, you know, you just keep networking and networking.
They're breaking a lot of bands too that then go on to the next level. Like, bands that I've put out recently, like Wild Throne or Whores, are starting to get, you know, much more recognition. You've seen, it's a stepping stone.
Even though it's small, maybe it's only one guy part-time, there can still be an upside. He still has relationships. He still may have things that can help you, even if he may not have the financial ability to. So I think in everything, it's a case-by-case situation.
For Trustkill and Ferret, which are, you know, RIP pretty much at this point, they all started out in the bedroom. They all started out as just a small side operation. They went on to do some pretty huge things.
We also dedicate ourselves like 110% to those bands that we're putting out, and usually because we don't put out as many releases either, so we're able to focus our attention on one band at a time.
You want to know what I think of your contract? Allow me to demonstrate. He wipes his ass with his record contract. I love this guy.
It's not as easy to sign bands anymore. Bands have more options. You know, when I started doing this in, you know, in the old days in 1987 at Roadrunner, there weren't that many labels. I was able to easily go in and get bands because there were not many labels. I had, you know, I could count my competitors on my fingers. Now, there's a billion labels. It's harder than ever to sell records, you know, because of everything you're competing with.
To sign acts and develop talent into you know, bands that can go out and draw 2,000 people is still something that is the same as it was years ago. But you know, the fact that everybody's selling less music changes the way you go about doing it, but it doesn't change the overall goal.
And you know, it was an evolution process. So I was looking at Slipknot before and after Corey Taylor over a 6-month period and getting new songs in, waiting for that moment that I felt the band was ready. You could do that back then. Now, the minute any band shows even the slightest bit of potential, some label's gonna jump in because you have to sign it that early to get it before anyone else. If you wait for it to be ready, then when it is ready, you're gonna have to compete with 50 other labels to sign it. So you gotta sign shit when it's undeveloped before it's ready to be signed, which sucks. You know, that's why there's so much crap getting signed these days, because labels are signing everything. Bands that shouldn't be signed, bands that aren't ready to be signed, bands that haven't matured and developed yet, but they're signing them and putting their records out because they want to beat the next guy to the punch.
Hi, I'm Frankie Sharp, Sharp Records. I saw your performance in my limo. I must tell you, it was terrific.
Yeah.
In fact, I think it's so good, I'm going to give you a 6-album deal starting tomorrow.
Let's be honest, a lot of these bands starting out are stupid kids, and they're going to want labels just because, A, they think that's what they're supposed to do, and B, they don't know what they're doing, and they just want, you know, somebody to come along and be like, sign this, go to the studio, we'll take care of the rest. And that's, you know, labels will be that middleman for you.
I think a lot of the labels that are around today have done a great job, and they still do a great job, but there's still a lot of work to be done. I mean, streaming is in its infancy, and a lot of that outcome still remains to be seen.
Maybe the game's gonna change when one of these big streaming companies really breaks out and people are like, this is the one we're gonna use, and you know, who knows where it's going to go from there.
The labels that are still around have figured out how to do it. You know, they figured out what they need to do to stay in business. And they've adjusted. You know, they figured out what they need to do in the modern marketplace to keep their bands relevant.
The labels that don't have their shit together will definitely go away. There will be less labels, but more focused labels, I think.
I don't think labels will ever go away. I mean, there's always going to be bands that need a financial backing and help with the business side of putting out their records. But I also think that self-releasing records is here to stay. And it's pretty amazing that bands have the option to work their record in a professional climate on their own terms. And it really comes down to what type of band or person that you are. But the choice is yours, and that's a pretty amazing thing.
Will everyone last? No. And are, you know, is everyone going to be successful? No. But can anyone really do it? I would say, yeah, they absolutely can.
The bar has been raised so high that you have to make a fucking masterpiece. You have to make Black Sabbath Paranoid, or, you know, to get people's attention. Anything short of that, you're just going to be competing in a sea of white noise to get people's attention. So the gauntlet's been thrown down to bands to do that, to come up with like the greatest music of all time. And if you do that, maybe you can win like bands in the old days did.
Too many people have the sauce. Too many people support.